Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Trinity for our Sunday worship service. A special welcome also to our visitors this morning. What a joy it is to be able to have the children singing for worship today. In a service where we're looking at yet again one of those hard truths that money, stuff, boy, it sure can make life a little bit more comfortable in the short term, but it doesn't do us a bit of good, especially in that moment when we die. The order of worship that will follow this morning is the one printed in your service folder. Let's join in that opening hymn. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed are they whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered.
Blessed are they whose sins the Lord does not count against them.
Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Almighty and merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed what we have devised and desired in our hearts. We have offended you and sinned against your holy law. We have done those things that we should not have done, and we have not done those things that we should have done. Have mercy on us, Lord. Spare us, forgive us, and restore us according to your promises in Christ Jesus. God, our merciful Father, has forgiven all our sins. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and our Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his death on the cross, and freed us from death by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God now and forever.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. With you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Mercifully grant, O God, that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts, for without your help we are unable to please you. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. The heart and core of every one of our worship services is always going to be that Word of God. And this morning, the Word of God reminds us of this hard truth that stuff, money, it might make life a little bit more comfortable, but it really can't help you, especially at the end of life. People in old times also sometimes had a very high standard of living. We're reminded of that in our first lesson from the book of Amos, the 6th chapter. Woe to you who are complacent in Zion, you who feel secure on Mount Samaria, you distinguished people of the leading nation to whom the house of Israel comes. Travel to Calneh and look. Go from there to Hamath Rabbah and go down to Gath of the Philistines. Are you better than those kingdoms? Are their territories greater than your territory? You who are trying to put off the evil day, you bring near the session for violence. Those who lie on ivory beds, sprawling upon their couches, eating lambs from the flock and calves straight from the stall, improvising tunes on the lyre, composing music for themselves on musical instruments like David, drinking large bowls of wine. They slather themselves with the most expensive perfumed oils, but they do not grieve over the ruin of Joseph. That is why they will go into exile as the first of the exiles. Those who sprawl out at their feasts for the dead will depart. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We have before us the psalm for the day. I believe we're going to sing it. Very good. I think this is a new one, but we had a men's group practice some singing on Thursday night, so I'll look to those men to help in the leading of the singing of the Psalm of the day, Psalm 146, Part A. Our second lesson for this morning comes from the book of Hebrews, the 13th chapter, beginning at verse 1. We're in the conclusion of this book, so it makes sense that the inspired writer is going to give us some various advice that will really bring blessings to the life of a believer. Continue to show brotherly love. Do not fail to show love to strangers, for by doing this, some have welcomed angels without realizing it. Remember those in prison, as if you were fellow prisoners, and those who are mistreated, as if you yourselves were also suffering bodily. Marriage is to be held in honor by all, and the marriage bed is to be kept undefiled, for God will judge sexually immoral people and adulterers. Keep your life free from the love of money, and be content with what you have, for God has said, I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. So then we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, and I will not be afraid. What will man do to me? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue with the singing of our children, the choir. Thank you. We thank the children for beautifying our worship service this morning. As now we turn again to the word of the Lord, please stand. The gospel for this Sunday is also the basis for the sermon. Luke 16, we begin at verse 19. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, living in luxury every day. A beggar named Lazarus had been laid at his gate. Lazarus was covered with sores and longed to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Besides this, the dogs also came and licked his sores. Eventually, the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far away and Lazarus at his side. He called out and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in misery in this flame." But Abraham said, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things and Lazarus received bad things, but now he is comforted here and you are in misery. Besides all this, a great chasm has been set in place between us and you, so that those who want to cross from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us." He said, "Then I beg you, Father, send him to my father's home, because I have five brothers, to warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment." Abraham said, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them." "No, Father Abraham," he said, "but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent." Abraham replied to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced even if someone rises from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. And at this point, let's have the new old guy or the old new pastor try a children's message. So if there are any children bold enough to come forward with a new pastor, please do that right now. Ah, good. A few at least. Because I'm really excited about this message. I have been trying to listen and learn about the congregation, and I realized that I moved from way, way so far north that it was north of the tree line, and there wasn't quite as much fishing and hunting, especially when the snow got to be 8 feet deep. Come on forward. There still is room. Sounds like a hymn. But I have been noticing that this congregation is richly blessed with a lot of people who really take their fishing seriously. And we have guides here. And we have people that I believe are even in the Fishing Hall of Fame. Oh, I can only dream. But I think it might be possible. Because I've noticed that, typically speaking, when you hire a guide to go fishing, what kind of fish are you trying to catch? Muskies, yeah, musky hunters, huh? You don't even call them fishermen anymore because they're so big. So I've noticed, yeah, crappies. Now you're getting down to what I'm thinking. I think that in my semi-retirement-ish, I keep getting a news feed that says I need more of a side hustle. That's the term they use. So I'm going to start a guide service. I'm going to fill a niche that needs to be filled. I'm going to call it the Triple P Guide Service. The Triple P Guide Service. I need somebody who maybe could read this for me. I wish I had this bigger. I should have made a slide. You want to try to read that? What does that say?
Pastors.
Puny.
Puny.
Huh? Huh? Oh, pardon me. Pardon me. Pastor's Puny Perch Guide Service. I need help making a logo for this. I need help from the congregation for an ad campaign. I think this could really work well. Because I tell you what, when I go fishing, I can make this puny perch guaranteed. You're going to catch puny perch, hand over fist. I mean, the live well, well, I don't have a live well. I got a basket. We're going to keep this cheap. It'll be full. Puny perch with extra protein guaranteed. And that means they've got grubs. Okay. And this is going to work so well because my overhead will be so minimal. I mean, on Bass Pro Shops about 5 years ago, I bought I don't know how many of these Shakespeare Synergy microcast titanium little reels. $5 a pop. Huh? I can make sure everybody's got one of those with this wonderful micro graphite. You notice the theme? Micro, micro, all the way through. Everything's going to be micro, including my master's net. That's what it is, master's net. This puppy unfolds and it extends a mighty 2 inches. What more do you need? I have bait. I have switched over to plastics. Can you tell I'm excited? I have switched over to plastics because the minnows I want to use for this, they're bigger than the fish. So, you know, I got the power bait trout worms. I got the power bait grubs. I've got box after box of these tiny little jigs that I want to make sure I open the right way or they will be all over the floor of the sanctuary and you're not going to be happy. Look at that. Huh? I tell you what, we're all set. What's that? You like them? They're tiny. They're micro. They're micro. So, after the service, I'm going to talk to some of the guides. I'm going to get your advice. And I might guess that maybe you'll tell me this isn't going to be a success. You might tell me that even though I promised to take people out on my micro pontoon boat, I have a mighty tune mini pontoon boat. Can you believe it? Everything's mini. And yet I probably won't get any customers. What do you think? No customers? Terrible failure? What's that? 1,000 customers. I like this kid. You're going to do my publicity. You know, sometimes we come up with what might be considered harebrained plans. And some things we do in life will fail. But this morning we want to be reminded that we're always a success. We always win in a certain way simply because we're connected to Jesus Christ. And that's why the Apostle Paul could say, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Let's bow our heads for a quick prayer, please. Lord Jesus, we praise and thank you that you've washed us clean in your blood and that you have given us a life that stretches into eternity itself. That helps us keep us strong, keep us focused, gives us comfort and confidence and hope, even in those times when maybe we fail a little bit. Thank you, Jesus, for always being with us. Amen. And thanks for coming forward. You can go back to your seats. Let's continue with the pre-sermon hymn. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The word of God that guides us this morning is our gospel reading, that parable, that story that Jesus once taught about the rich man and poor Lazarus. And at the end, I'd just like to focus on this part of the portion again, where there's been this request to send Lazarus back from the dead to try to shock the rich man's brothers into believing. Abraham said, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them." "No, Father Abraham," he said, "but if someone from the dead goes to them, they will repent." Abraham replied to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." This is the word of the Lord. I pray we're blessed by its study this morning. As we consider again this basic question, who are the real winners in life? Who are the losers? And then let me make it more personal. Which one are you? Which one am I? And now I'm not talking about sports. I suppose I could have brought a basketball out for the children's message, but I'd never figured out how to spin it on a finger. And even in my good days, my best days, 50 years ago, dunking a basketball, my goal was to touch the bottom of the net. I'm not talking about winning or losing in something like a board game, Settlers of Catan. That was huge in campus ministry. Others preferred an old game, Monopoly. In this neck of the woods, there might be some of you who are experts at Sheep's Head. I'm not talking about trying to win in business or even in school. I'd just like us to keep this thought about winning and losing in front of us as we try to unwrap the truths that Jesus wants us to learn from this parable of the rich man and poor Lazarus, which arguably could have a subtitle: Looks Can Be Deceiving. So now we come back to this leading question: who's the true winner or loser in life? And as you start to look at Jesus' parable, the story, the obvious answer would be, on earth, the loser? That's got to be Lazarus. Because how did Jesus describe him? A beggar named Lazarus had been laid at his gate. Lazarus was covered with sores and longed to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Besides this, the dogs also came and licked his sores. Lazarus was a beggar. You and I hear that word and we have certain images in our mind, maybe of somebody still standing along the highway with a sign, "We'll work for food." And yet it's a little different in Jesus' day. There was no social welfare net. There were some people who, because of health issues or whatever, they begged for a living. They'd have friends and family carry them to important spots where hopefully the passersby will have a little pity. And that's what seems to have happened with Lazarus. In fact, the Greek gives us this idea that he wasn't just placed at the rich man's gate, he was thrown there. Now, maybe that means he couldn't walk and others had to carry him. But, you know, also think of this, he's covered with sores. So was that a little disgusting for other people to be around? Were they even afraid that it would be contagious? After all, the dogs are licking him. Nothing about Lazarus here screams success. So as we begin to think about this and we come back to the question, winner or loser? Quick analysis. Which would you say? It's a no-brainer. From the perspective of our world, Lazarus is a waste of space. He's nothing but a loser. Now contrast him with the rich man, the way Jesus depicts him in this little story. He wears purple. And we all go, "Oh, a Vikings fan." No, not back then. Mentioning the fact that he wore purple meant that this guy really was rolling in money, because the only way they could make purple dye back then was from a special kind of shellfish, and the entire process was very detailed, so that there are those historians who say basically however many ounces of purple dye you had, it was worth its weight in silver. And then on top of that, this man can afford to have his clothes made out of fine linen. That's mighty pricey. He lives in luxury. So Jesus piles up this picture. This is the guy who's really living the dream. Every day, no problems whatsoever. Eats what he wants, when he wants, parties with his best friends. The lifestyle back then at times, the amenities they had, that might surprise us. This man probably had indoor plumbing. He might well have had a heated pool and hot water to use. Some did back then. He probably had a front row box seat for all sporting events. And when he died, I suspect he had lots of people who praised good old Ebenezer. Boy, that man really knew how to live, didn't he? He knew how to party. So again, the quick analysis, winner or loser? From a human standpoint, it's obvious. He is a winner. But now let's look at this again from God's perspective, because you see, God sees everything differently. God views every individual, you and me, from the perspective of eternity. And that's why this particular parable turns instantly. The story turns and pivots in the moment of death, because in death, the rich man becomes the loser. Because what happened to the rich man when he was buried? Jesus keeps it very blunt and brief here. He died. He was buried. Then what? He went to hell, where he was in torment. And now we better ask the question, why? Was it because he had so much good stuff, so much money in life? No. Stuff and money in and of itself can be good or bad. It all depends on our attitude toward it. We can view it as a wonderful, rich blessing. Abraham, for example, very wealthy individual. And yet by God's grace, in the moment of death, he went home to heaven. This rich man had a problem because when God looked at his heart, what he saw there was ugly. What he saw there was empty. He saw no Christ. He saw no cross. He saw only a dollar sign. And again, money, used properly, makes life comfortable, becomes a blessing. But in the moment of death, when's the last time you saw a hearse pulling a U-Haul? It does you no good. And yet, we don't learn. Tragically, the story of the rich man has been repeated far too many times in history. You and I could probably share some stories of famous individuals, even from recent years, that have fallen down this tragic pothole of wealth. But I'm a little older, so I'm going to use an illustration from about 100 years ago. 1923, a group of the world's most successful financiers all met in Chicago at the Edgewater Beach Hotel. These were the movers and shakers of the roaring 20s. Life was good, business was good, they were making money hand over fist. They were so successful that for years already, newspapers and magazines were sharing their stories and were urging the youth of that nation of that time to emulate them, copy them. But now let's check in on those same financiers some 27 years later. So let's see, 1923, 27 years. So we're doing a check in 1950. And by then, Richard Whitney, former president of the New York Stock Exchange, he had been serving time in Sing Sing. He cut a few too many corners. Albert Fall, the name is appropriate. Boy, did he fall. Even though he had once been a member of the president's cabinet, he was pardoned from prison just so that he could go home to die as a pauper. Jesse Livermore, the great bear of Wall Street, some called him the Wolf of Wall Street. You know, that became famous even because of a movie made a long time later. He committed suicide. Leon Frazier, president of the Bank of International Settlement, committed suicide. Ivar Krieger, the head of one of the world's greatest monopolies. They called him the Match King. And no, not because of a service online, but because of the literal thing called a match, he committed suicide. So our analysis, when all is said and done, winner or loser? But now we come back to the parable, and we come back to Lazarus. In the moment of his death, what happened to that lonesome loser? We're told the angels carried him to Abraham's side in heaven above. So think of this. One moment, he's got dog breath in his face. Oh! The next moment, he has Jesus wrapping him in his arms. He comes to absolute security, complete fulfillment, total eternal bliss. So what would you say, winner? Yeah. And now we come back once more for a moment to the rich man. While his friends were probably still eulogizing him, the rich man's already surrounded by the flames of hell, as Jesus taught it. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far away and Lazarus at his side. He called out and said, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am misery in this flame." But there could be no pity, because there's no crossing over. There's no second chances after death. You land in hell, that's where you stay. Lazarus couldn't come over and help. Nobody could. So this rich man was eternally lost to burn in hell forever. Winner or loser? And why did it work out this way? Some get confused because of the way Jesus fleshes out this parable and the words of Abraham about Lazarus's hard life in this world. But that's not what got him into heaven. It wasn't as if God looked down and said, "Well, Lazarus, you already had what people would call hell on earth, so now I'm going to cut you some slack." Instead, Jesus used this picture to drive home a basic truth. There's only one way to get into heaven. Jesus said that in so many words, right? In the upper room. "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And Lazarus ends up being a powerful example of being saved by undeserved love, by grace alone. Because think about it. What, in the moment of his death, what could Lazarus offer God? Money? Didn't have any. Success? Not any that I could see, except what was in his heart, the cross, Christ. Lazarus drives home the truth of this basic verse, "By grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, lest anyone could boast." So Lazarus becomes the ultimate winner, which is what the Lord wants for you and me too. It's why the Apostle Paul once said in Philippians, the third chapter, "But even more than that, I consider everything to be a loss," whatever he might have in life, "because of what is worth far more." And what is that? "Knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have lost all things and consider them rubbish, so that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own which comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God by faith." Whether you're a winner or loser in life, it has nothing to do with your grades, although kids, trust me, your teachers and your parents want you to work hard at that. Whether you're a winner or loser in life, it really has nothing to do with the success of your business, how good you are at sports, how good-looking you are, or well-dressed you are. Looks can be deceiving. It's all about what's inside, the cross and Christ. And that's true for you and me, and that's also true for everybody around us. That's why Jesus added a footnote to this particular parable, looking ahead to others and their moment of death, to remind us that in the future, the losers, that would include the rich man's brothers. And isn't it tragic that all of this would happen? Isn't it tragic that too late, far too late, The rich man realized what was really important in heaven above. This was really shock treatment for him. It's true what they say, there are no atheists in hell. And yet we don't really see repentance there. Instead, he first asked for pity. And when that can't happen, then he said, I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's home, because I have five brothers to warn them, so that they will not also come to this place of torment. Rich man knew that his brothers probably not only inherited his physical wealth, but they inherited his value system. So the rich man knew that they were already dead men walking. They were losers in God's eyes. But he thought, maybe if you sent somebody like Lazarus back from the dead, I'll tell you what, that'd be a pretty powerful witness, right? That would shock them into repentance. And how does Jesus finish this little story? Abraham responds, Abraham replied to him, if they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. Borrowing a line from Scrooge in A Christmas Carol, they'd probably just dismiss Lazarus as a bit of undigested potato. They have Moses and the prophets. They will not be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. I've always found that statement to be rather ironic, actually doubly so. Because you know what? You follow the rest of Jesus' public ministry. And there was a fellow by the name of Lazarus, raised from the dead by Jesus. That final miracle shortly before Jesus' suffering and death on Calvary's cross. And the raising of Lazarus brought some people to Jesus. But what did it do to the leaders of the church? It caused them to hate Jesus all the more. And the chief priests made plans to kill Lazarus too, because it was on account of him that many of the Jews were leaving them and believing in Jesus. It hardened these leaders in their unbelief. They will not be convinced even if someone rises from the dead. The statement is doubly ironic in our sad world these days, because you know, the heart of the Christian faith is someone did. On the third day, on Easter morning. And when Jesus rose from the dead on Easter, he changed everything for every last one of us. He forever smashed the power of death and hell. He freed us from the shackles that bind us to Satan and sin. But there are still far too many losers in our world today who absolutely do not believe that. And you know what? These losers may be the most powerful politicians in the world. They may be the most beautiful actresses and actors, or nowadays I guess I'd have to say they would be influencers who have hundreds of thousands of followers on social media. These losers may be the most brilliant scientist in the laboratory, the most convincing professor in a classroom. Might be a roommate that we get along real well with we're away from home at a secular campus. Could be our best friend. Could be our main squeeze. Could be the neighbor that we have coffee with every morning. But if they don't believe in Jesus, they are losers. And now I've been using a term this morning that probably isn't acceptable anymore, right? It sounds disparaging, but I simply want to use that term as a statement of fact, because our Lord God tells us that if we don't believe in Jesus, we lose. We lose everything that the Lord gives so graciously and freely, all and only by His grace in Jesus alone. So now we come back at the end of this message to a very personal question. What are you, a winner or a loser? You might not be the most famous person in the world. You might once in a while come up with a harebrained scheme to have a side career like the Triple P Guide Service. You may not be that good looking. You may not be that influential in the community. But you know what? When you're a child of God, you have won everything. And that's what the Lord Himself says many a time in the Bible. I'm just going to pick this verse from 1 John, the 5th chapter. Everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world. Our faith. Who is the one who overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. This, my dear friends, is winning. Amen. Please stand. The grace of our Lord bless you and keep you, both now and into eternity. Amen. We stand together as a family of believers now with the privilege of being able to confess our Lord in the words of the Apostles' Creed as they're printed in your worship folder. We speak them in unison. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. We continue now with the prayer of the church, the responsive prayer in your worship folder. We have a number of special prayer requests this morning because of some of God's children who were blessed this past week to go home to heaven. So this morning we pray for the friends and family of Myrna Taylor, who went home to heaven this week. We pray for the friends and family of Chuck Feetz, who went home to heaven this week. We pray for the friends and family of Pastor Emeritus Walter Schumann, who at the age of 102 went home this week. I'll make sure after the service to give you all the funeral arrangements then in the announcements. Now in our prayers, we also pray for a little boy, Silas, 3 months old, Karen Ives' niece's son. Silas is in the intensive care unit, at least when I got this note. Severe case of collapsed lung, heart defect challenges. Anybody who struggled through illness, serious illness with a little one, knows how helpless that can make you feel. Let's take this all to our gracious Lord in heaven above in prayer. The prayer of the church. Almighty God and Father, we thank you for all your mercies, especially for the gift of your Son, through whom you have revealed your gracious will. We praise you for the Holy Spirit and his working through the means of grace. Strengthen and defend your church, that by your word and sacraments faith may grow and love toward all may increase. Keep our children in the grace of their baptisms. Enable their parents to train them in lives of faith.
Raise up Christians to serve you in the ministry of the word and in all godly walks of life.
Preserve our nation in justice and honor. Guide and bless all who make, administer, and judge our laws. Let your blessing rest on planting and harvest, commerce and industry, medicine and science, the arts and culture. Protect all who travel and care for those whose work is difficult or dangerous.
Be with all who devote themselves to any useful task.
Comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. Remember those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those for whom death draws near. And Lord God, now we place before you in our hearts and minds in prayer the family and friends of Chuck Feetz, Myrna Taylor, and Pastor Emeritus Walter Schumann. It is sad when we lose a loved one. We will miss them. And yet to know that these three individuals are now safe, forever in heaven above. What a comfort and what a blessing that is. Bless all these individuals that are affected in one way or another by this truth that Jesus spoke, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me will never die. And Lord God, even as we thank you for taking these children home to heaven, we come before you earnestly and we pray for little Silas, 3 months old. Bless the work of the doctors in that intensive care. And if you would be so gracious, spare his life and restore him to health. Give the family the strength, the confidence, the comfort, and the hope that ultimately can only come by knowing that you stand beside the bed of that little boy 24 hours a day, and you are watching over him. And hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. We remember with thanksgiving those who have loved and served you, who now rest from their labors. Console those who are mourning or living with sadness. Grant us these things, Father, for the sake of Jesus, who died and rose again.
Amen.
And now we'll have a musical interlude. During that song, we'd ask you to sign those friendship registers that are at the ends of the pews. And then immediately following that musical interlude, we'll go on to our next hymn, hymn 717, What is the World to Me? Please stand for our closing prayers and also for the Lord's blessing. Almighty God, we thank you for teaching us the things you want us to believe and do. Help us by your Holy Spirit to keep your word in pure hearts, that we may be strengthened in faith, guided in holiness, and comforted in life and in death, all through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. We close with the singing of a hymn that you'll need to use the hymn book for, Precious Lord. Please be seated. Thanks again for giving me the privilege of being able to worship with you and lead you in worship on a Sunday when we were reminded of a hard truth to hear at first, but then an easy truth at the end, to know that God gives us everything through Jesus the Savior. There are a number of announcements this morning, so I better put the reading glasses on and make sure I get them right, especially for those of you who'd like the announcements about the funerals that are coming up. First, the one that's going to be here, and that's the only reason I put it first. Myrna Taylor's funeral, our good Lord willing, will be this coming Friday, September the 30th at 11 a.m., visitation at 10 a.m. And I believe there's a sign-up list out there for bringing food for the funeral meal that's available in the fellowship hall. So again, Myrna, September 30th, 11 a.m., visitation at 10 a.m. Chuck Feetz's funeral has been planned by the family to be a little different. It's going to be at Zion Lutheran. down in Neshkoro, Wisconsin. I had to check a map because I didn't know exactly where that small town was. His funeral will be there Tuesday at 11 a.m. So keep the family and friends in your prayers for that one. I don't know how many of you would be going down there for that. And then Pastor Emeritus Walter Schumann, his service is going to be Monday at 11 at Trinity Watertown. Pastor Brett Brower will be the presiding minister for that. I believe visitation will go from 9 to 11. I think that's what I was told. I'm getting a head shake this way that I can see even through the reading glasses, which is challenging. By way of other announcements, we have a fellowship time this morning for an organist that's retiring, but a keyboardist that's not retiring, because I think I saw her at our first men's group for singing on Thursday night. We have a little time for Elaine Helwig this morning, so let's spend some time thanking her for her work. I believe there's a basket out on the table for cards if you'd like to share a card. And because of that, the new old new pastor, in collaboration with Pastor Luchterhan, we decided we're going to start Bible class a little bit later this morning, 10:30-ish. We want to make sure we have time for the fellowship. There won't be Sunday school this morning, and then I think the last announcement would be that you're going to see the Wells Connection right now. I'll greet you in the back. God's richest blessings.
Hi, I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. The goal of Wells Home Missions is simple: preach the gospel of Christ. And the truth is that the more churches that Wells Home Missions plants, the more that good news can be preached, preached to the people who need to hear about the forgiveness found in Jesus. People like Lauren.
If I've ever been to a baby's baptism. But I think what's interesting about doing it as an adult, it feels like a gift.
Lauren Glennie would be the first one to tell you she lived a life far away from God. Like a rising percentage of Americans, Lauren wasn't brought to church growing up. After her parents' divorce when she was a teenager, she was filled with worry, fear, and anxiety. She just wanted to escape it all. Alcohol was her go-to comfort, and it quickly got out of her control.
You know, you have pain, and you try to make sense of the pain and find a way to get some relief. And I was looking for relief in every other place, but God.
Despite wanting to become sober, Lauren's alcohol abuse continued for many years, until a very close friend, Adam, suddenly died in a car accident.
And it was devastating. It was really, really hard. And I think I saw how that affected everybody's that was still here, like his family, his friends. And I didn't want to do that to my family, and it kind of made me wake up.
In that moment, Lauren put an end to alcohol. And then, shortly after, she joined Adam's family at church one Sunday morning to support them. But that church just so happened to be In-Town Lutheran Church, a Wells Home Mission in Atlanta, Georgia.
Mission churches are, by nature of what they are, they're set up to reach people who are far from God and people who have questions.
Lauren brought her questions, and the church was ready to help her find answers. Through Bible information class and conversations with Christians at In-Town, Lauren came to find the peace, comfort, and forgiveness that only Jesus provides.
Learning God's love and grace for you and compassion and forgiveness, it's freeing. It's freeing, and it opens your eyes to a whole different way of living, to live life and look at life from a completely different perspective.
Lauren is just one example of the countless souls that are being connected to Jesus through Wells Home Mission Churches. However, there are so many more out there yet to be reached. That's why, starting in 2023, Wells is embarking on an ambitious initiative to plant 100 new missions in 10 years.
The lost are not out there raising their hands, screaming for us to come out to them. They don't know they're lost. We know the gospel. We know what Jesus has done for us. We know we have a message that's always relevant, because no matter what's going on in the world, the gospel is always there to give us peace, to give us joy, to give us comfort, to give us hope.
The reality of the harvest being plentiful, but the workers being few, is certainly a struggle in many of our Wells congregations at the moment. However, Pastor Mark Gabb says there's really no other option besides to go. Go and make disciples.
If we try to hold back and say we got to hunker down and we got to try to fill the vacancies before we go out and we create more missions or more vacancies, I'm not really sure that's even following what Jesus told us to do with the Great Commission. He said to go, and that includes nurturing, but that also includes outreach. We would rather fail trying to do this than fail to try it. If we fail to try it, we won't accomplish it. But if we have a God who can do immeasurably more than ever that we ask or imagine, if we have a God who can do that, then why not try it, see how He blesses it, and give God praise for however He blesses it.
God willing, this initiative will have an eternal impact on people all over North America. People that we may not know yet, but people for whom Jesus Christ died for. People that our Heavenly Father wants to welcome into His family with open, loving arms.
We have a message that needs to get out there. When I talk to people and see people that are hurting and they don't know this peace of God that transcends all understanding, and I know by God's grace we have it, that just excites me for the future.
My faith allows me to wake up every day and just focus on the 24 hours ahead of me. And because I'm not in control, because I know I'm not in control, I don't have to worry about tomorrow or 5 years down the line. And I don't have to worry about the past because God forgave me for it. It's life-changing, clearly. It really, really is.
Within the last 10 years, Wells Home Missions has been planting, on average, about 6 or 7 home mission congregations per year across the continent. That means that, although the goal of 10 mission congregations every year for 10 years is bold, it's certainly not outrageous, especially considering our God is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. You can hear more of Lauren's story and learn how you can get involved in this initiative by visiting our website,